Hi there, I'm Ryan Bonazzo. Welcome to Northwest Newsweek. The Wunnumin Lake First Nation is pleading for help from senior levels of government after three tragedies in less than 2 days. A pair of youth deaths and the passing of an elder have shaken the community of just over 500 members. Wunnumin Lake leaders and representatives from Anishinaabe Nation say more support is needed as soon as possible. Corey Nordstrom has that story.
The people of Wunnumin Lake First Nation are still reeling after multiple tragedies struck their community last week. Over a 36-hour period, a youth fell from the top of the microwave tower. His death was witnessed by another youth who took his own life after seeing the incident, and an elder living off reserve passed away before his family could see him.
It's devastating because what happened on the fall from a microwave tower that's around 300 or more feet height, and he was at the top. People saw him falling down. That's something we've never witnessed.
Wunnumin Lake leaders were joined by NAN officials as they pleaded to Ottawa and the province for support during this difficult time. Their requests include immediate mental health and intervention supports, additional policing and security to support the community, and to establish dedicated mechanisms with capacity building and resources to empower the community to respond to similar experiences in the future.
Just yesterday, we had a young, I wouldn't say man, it's a child, got medevaced out because of attempted suicide. And that's why we need our people to have security and monitor the community homes.
A long-standing issue, there's no counseling available for the people or young people of our northern communities. Everyone knows one another. There's phone-in lines which don't do it.
We need professional support. We don't have psychiatrists or psychologists or whatever we need for mental health. We don't have those.
Corey Nordstrom, TBT News.
Anishinaabeg police say the victim of a fatal ATV crash this past week on the Gnugaming First Nation is a 14-year-old girl from Long Lac. Her name isn't being released at the request of the family. APS responded to the incident around 2 o'clock on Monday afternoon. Police say the ATV, which was being driven by the girl, left the roadway and rolled over. She suffered a serious head injury and died en route to the Greenstone Hospital. Meanwhile, friends, family, and colleagues of the pilot who died in a plane crash at the Thunder Bay Airport earlier this month say he had a deep passion for aviation and always had a smile on his face. They're now mourning his tragic passing. Pete Belotis was just 30 years old. According to posts on social media, he graduated from the Air Cadets in Nova Scotia in 2008 as a squadron commander. Over the past few years, he worked for Bearskin Airlines and Meg Aerospace, living in Thunder Bay and flying all around Northern Ontario and beyond. On the evening of August 16th, Belotis was attempting to fly to Dryden in a Bird Dog airplane owned by Meg when he encountered problems just after takeoff and crashed onto the runway. Belotis was pronounced dead soon after. The Transportation Safety Board continues to investigate the cause of the fatal crash. Ontario's Special Investigations Unit has found no grounds to lay charges against two Atikokan OPP officers after a 37-year-old man died of a drug overdose while in custody last October. According to the SIU report, the man initially resisted arrest for breaching conditions of a release order. When police were able to subdue him, he admitted to consuming alcohol, but denied using any drugs. Later that evening, the man fell from his bunk onto the floor of a cell. He was initially responsive, but stopped breathing shortly thereafter. Paramedics were called, and the man died in hospital. The SIU concluded that the officers did not commit a criminal offense in connection with the death. Tempers often flare during a political campaign, but one Thunder Bay Superior North candidate insists a group of opposition supporters in Greenstone recently took things too far. Liberal Patty Haidu says she was publicly harassed and intimidated by supporters of the People's Party of Canada. A lengthy video of the encounter has been circulating online. Some of her political opponents have condemned the behavior, but PPC candidate Rick Daines maintains the group didn't do anything wrong in this instance. Catalina Gillies has details.
This is not a livable Canada! Bring back Canada! Bring back Canada!
It's the third federal election campaign for Thunder Bay Superior North incumbent Patty Hajdu. But the Liberal candidate says she's never experienced anything like this before. During a recent visit to the Greenstone area, Hajdu says she was publicly harassed by a group of people upset about mask mandates and other pandemic restrictions. The group included some wearing People's Party of Canada t-shirts and even members of PPC candidate Rick Daines' political team.
It was meant to be intimidating. It was meant to drive me out of the town. In fact, many of them said, you are not welcome here. You need to leave. We don't want you here. And it certainly doesn't reflect many of the conversations I had with other residents throughout those 2 days. I haven't seen that before in Thunder Bay Superior North. And it is for me alarming that a candidate would allow that behavior to continue.
PPC candidate Daines confirms that two people in the video are a part of his campaign team. And while he insists he doesn't condone harassment on the campaign trail, he doesn't believe the group crossed the line.
There are two sides to every story. Often there's more than two sides. And unfortunately, there's only one side that's being allowed to be spoken. I don't condone, you know, confrontation or aggression in any way. If anyone perceives it as that way, then I would agree. I also don't condone a federal minister of health or a member of parliament, or even just a campaigning candidate, to turn their back on people and say, I'm not here to talk to you.
Other Thunder Bay Superior North candidates also shared their thoughts. The NDP's Chantel Bryson wrote this on Twitter. The NDP and I do not tolerate any harassment from our supporters. No whisper campaigns, false news, or in-person harassment of those with opposing views. She also says Daines has a responsibility to put a stop to this kind of behavior. Green Party candidate Amanda Mottajung says politics needs to stop being so divisive. Mottajung adds candidates should not be focused on, quote, this tomfoolery. Conservative hopeful Joshua Taylor chose not to comment, but wanted to clear up any misconception that the group is associated with his campaign. Hajdu says she will visit the area again before the campaign ends and that the mayor of Greenstone, Ronald Boyu, apologized for the incident. She's also calling on all candidates to ensure their teams fully commit to engaging with constituents in a safe and respectful way. Catalina Gillies, TBT News.
Federal NDP leader Jagmeet Singh visited the region this week. First with a whistle stop in Kenora, followed by a trip to Thunder Bay to deliver a campaign announcement on universal pharmacare. Our TBT News crews also spoke to Singh about a number of regional topics, including his plan for Fednor if he's elected Prime Minister. Corey Nordstrom has the story.
Jagmeet Singh made his second visit to Thunder Bay in the last month, announcing his pledge for universal pharmacare. The NDP leader also voiced his opinion on Fednor, where he believes the current Liberal government has taken the wrong approach.
The no strings attached approach hasn't worked. So if we make investments, they have to be tied to jobs. There is no point in Fednor making an investment in a sector or in an industry or in a company if there aren't ironclad guarantees that it's actually going to create a benefit for workers.
More work for the local Alstom plant could also be in the cards if Singh is elected Prime Minister.
When we're purchasing with our public dollars, so we're buying trains for Via Rail, the Canadian Crown Corporation, we should be buying Canadian-made products.
Singh spoke with regional First Nations leaders while in the city as he looks to create plans that address some of their needs. They mentioned inadequate housing and the lack of clean drinking water as issues that further their feelings of hopelessness.
When we talk about the mental health crisis, we need investments in mental health. We need supports for Indigenous-led learning on the ground, on the land. There's a lot of on-the-land healing that can happen with good programs. But we also need to make sure that the quality of life in terms of housing and clean drinking water, when those are established, it really makes life better.
Singh also pledges to make access to clean drinking water a priority if his government takes power. Corey Nordstrom, TBT News.
Candidates are officially on the move looking for support in the wake of that snap election call from Prime Minister Justin Trudeau earlier this month. As part of our election coverage, we've spoken with the candidates to get their take on the issues and what they believe will get them elected. This week, we're looking at the Kenora riding. Adam Riley has more on Conservative incumbent Eric Melillo.
It's been just shy of 2 years since Eric Melillo was elected to serve as the MP for Kenora, but he is once again pounding the pavement, speaking to the electorate, and seeking their support. But unlike last time, he is not the challenger. He's the incumbent, with a track record he needs to either defend or bring attention to.
Whether it's the infrastructure investments we need, drinking water on reserve, or standing up for the small businesses in our region, it's been a pleasure to serve these past 2 years.
And what a 2 years it has been. 5 months after being elected, Melillo, along with the rest of the world, had to come to terms and adapt to living in a global pandemic, something that is still on the minds of voters as he campaigns in the riding.
Everyone's obviously focused on getting through these final stages of the pandemic and really focused on a recovery so that we can get people back to work, we can get our businesses going again and really get the country back on track, because it's not just the health crisis that the pandemic has caused, but we're also now in a deep recession, one of the worst recessions we've had since the Depression.
Melillo believes his party and the platform it wants to deliver to Canadians will address the issues that face the Kenora riding, including broadband internet access, which he says the pandemic has proven is not a luxury, but a necessity. Promising if given a majority, all Canadian households will have access to high-speed internet by the end of their term. As well, he says there will be a focus put on rural Canada.
We will appoint a Minister of Rural Affairs, and we will ensure that there is a specific funding stream for infrastructure in rural areas, whether it's highways, bridges, you name it, across the region. We want to make sure that rural and northern Canada, including northwestern Ontario, has its fair share of funds.
Canadians go to the polls on September 20th. Adam Riley, Northwest Newsweek.
Melillo will have to fend off four challengers. Mitchell Ringos has more on David Bruno, who's looking to retake the riding for the Liberals.
We are the party that's been able to weather this hurricane of a pandemic. There's much more work to come.
That is only one of the messages Liberal candidate David Bruno has for the voters as he canvasses neighborhoods in the Kenora riding, a riding that until 2 years ago was held by the Liberals. And while some have expressed concerns over the decision by Justin Trudeau to call a snap election, Bruno says the Liberals have a track record of getting things done and believes it's what's needed to help steer Canada through the pandemic.
We need this mandate right now to clear the way to save ourselves from a possible fourth wave. And I believe that with our policies, we're going to weather our way through it. You know, for the last 2 years, what we've realized is that it's very hard to govern on a minority government, especially when you have the opposition parties with a knife to your throat, constantly wanting something for their base in exchange for what you're trying to do for the population.
And while Bruno may be a newcomer to the riding, he is no spring chicken in the political world, as he previously ran for the Northern Ontario Party in Thunder Bay Atikokan and challenged the Liberal nomination in Thunder Bay Rainy River, but was ultimately unsuccessful against Marcus Pawlowski. He has also helped craft legislation for the Liberals using his expertise in cybersecurity to help compose Bill C-11, also known as the Digital Charter Implementation Act. When it comes to the issues, Bruno notes the twinning of the Trans-Canada Highway and broadband internet access are a big concern, along with others that hit home for him.
We've got to take care of our seniors. I have an elderly mother as well that I look after, my family as well. And these are the issues that most people have to deal with. Apart from that, climate change is ever present. I mean, again, I don't have to reiterate that our forests are on fire and we have to make radical change.
Mitchell Ringos, Northwest Newsweek.
When we come back, we'll continue our coverage of candidates running in the Kenora riding. Stay with us. Welcome back. We continue our coverage of the Kenora race. The NDP's Janine Seymour is looking to bring the party its first ever win in that riding. Adam Riley has more on that.
Everything in front of me, I look to it as an opportunity. So even though it's a summer snap election in Kenora, like that is an opportunity.
Ever since the Kenora riding was established in its current form in 2003, the NDP have never been able to win the riding. But Janine Seymour believes this time voters are ready for change. But the Kenora area lawyer admits there is some work to be done before that can happen.
I understand that timing and not many people know me unless you were in court or ran around in legal circles. You probably didn't cross my path. And because I spent so much time being educated outside the province, that's another barrier. But I'm homegrown from the community. I'm definitely committed and somebody localized. So I hope that people are encouraged and come out and get to meet me and get to know me.
As she meets, speaks, and listens to voters, Seymour says the pandemic and the hardships it has caused is a common theme brought up, but notes many also don't want a direct return to normal.
We've been isolated and gone through a global trauma, and we're wanting to get back into it, but not return to status quo. They're wanting change.
Seymour says that change comes in the form of the NDP's platform, which she believes will have a direct impact on the Kenora riding, and if elected, wants to see a priority put on the region.
We're not as connected geographically where we're placed and the barriers that exist here. So I would be insisting on resources appropriately spent where the need is, and it's here.
Adam Riley, Northwest Newsweek.
The Green Party saw a notable increase in support during the 2019 election in Kenora. But this time, the party has both a new leader and a new candidate. Jonathan Wilson has the details.
In 2019, the Green Party placed fourth in the Kenora riding with slightly less than 1,500 votes, the party's best showing in the riding's history. This time, Green candidate Remy Rout is hoping to not only boost those numbers, but let voters know there is an alternative to the big three parties and that the Greens will directly represent constituents.
It's not just about party politics or party policies. The Green Party is grassroots. So each constituency is a little bit different. They have different requirements. We do have some core values, but each constituent is a little bit different, the same as people.
Prior to putting his hat into the ring this year, Rout was involved with various political parties, but was drawn to the Green Party due to the autonomy that is given to candidates. As well, his most recent business venture was geared towards green technologies. When he speaks with voters, he says it is important to take the time to hear what their concerns are, and so far has found what he believes are the three biggest issues in the region.
Number one, like I said, it's not just about climate here. It is important because of the beauty of this area. Number two, it's about opioid crisis and homelessness, but those are connected. And the other one that comes in is safety. People are looking for safety.
With just 3 weeks left in the campaign, Rout feels optimistic that he can make a case to voters that he is the right person to represent the riding in Ottawa.
Change needs to happen, and change can only happen when people vote and voice. So let's hope for the best.
Jonathan Wilson, Northwest Newsweek.
Earlier this week, the People's Party of Canada announced it has also found a candidate in Kenora. Unfortunately, Craig Martin wasn't available to speak with us this week. We'll have more on his campaign in the weeks to come. Coming up after the break, reconciliation and repatriation in Lac Seul as the Anglican Church and the First Nation gather to commemorate the transfer of land back to the community. Wednesday was a historic day for the Lac Seul First Nation. Land that was used and later abandoned by the Anglican Church was returned to its original caretakers. It's meant to be a step toward reconciliation with the community, which recently won an appeal in the Supreme Court of Canada regarding the land they were flooded out of almost a century ago. Adam Riley has details.
On a remote point of land on the north shore of Lac Seul, accessible only by boat or a very long off-the-beaten-path detour, sits the former Anglican church, the former residence of its minister, and a small cemetery, which is home to the remains of many former Lac Seul residents. For years, the land has sat abandoned, but now is back under the stewardship of the Lac Seul First Nation after the band purchased the land from the church for $11, in a move Chief Clifford Bull is calling an act of true reconciliation.
I thank the church for offering that amount, and I think for them to show that is a good gesture and a way towards reconciliation and healing for all the things that have gone wrong in the past for Indigenous peoples across Canada.
Dignitaries from various organizations and government agencies toured around the land, carefully doing their best to avoid stepping on a gravestone or final resting place before the dedication of a plaque to commemorate both the event and the location. Reverend Canon Dr. Murray Still, representing the Anglican Church, says walking the grounds and touring the structures gave a reverence of the past, and agrees with Bull.
Repatriation means that the people can now restore these grounds, these lands, and do with them as they have done for centuries, and find their way back to living off the land that is now theirs once again. It's an exciting time for the Lac Seul people. It's an exciting time for the church to be involved in real reconciliation.
Plans for the land are still in its early stages, but Bull says with assistance from the Anglican Church and the purchase of an underground radar system, the community plans to locate and identify the bodies in the cemetery, as well build space for residents to visit family who were interred there. Adam Riley, TBT News.
After being canceled in 2020, the Emo Fall Fair returned to its agricultural roots this year. An entrance featuring some fair royalty brought dozens of spectators as one of the largest parades in recent memory finished its drive through the town. Without rides, it was a number of staples that brought in visitors from across the district. Exhibition halls showcased prizes for local work like knitting and other art. And of course, the food is always a big draw, as are the equestrian events. Fair Committee Chair James Gibson says the event was greatly missed by the entire community, especially its youth.
Well, breaks the summer up for them too. They have the fair and then they go back to school and kind of breaks the summer up. You know, when people haven't been out for a year and a half, it's easy to come out and talk, and it's easy to be entertained after a year and a half.
It left a hole in our community, and it definitely was not, it was missed, but it was something we just had to get by with, and due to what happened and with the COVID and whatnot, but glad to see some normalcy back.
Gibson says they couldn't afford the necessary insurance for amusement rides this year, as they usually split costs with Thunder Bay and Dryden. Dryden is also hosting a similar style fair this weekend. Well, that'll do it for this week's edition of Northwest Newsweek. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.